gosh, I'm that age now when things like that sound like someone's reading one's obituary, really. Just to reassure you, I'm alive and well. I've given out copies of an outline of the talk, and I think, you know, in a way, what I'm trying to do tonight is give you a sort of a panoramic sort of overview of issues, really, as they focus on Britain. I think Helen has sort of handed these outlines out. And so I'm going to start with a little bit of history before we jump into you know, the actual topic of relations in Britain. So I'll start with a little bit of history on Islam and interreligious Christian-Muslim relations. Then I'll talk a little bit about a bit of sociology of the Muslim communities who are here in Britain today. Because in a way, there is no, when we talk about Muslims in Britain, there is no one Muslim community. There are a diversity of communities with a radically different set of histories, backgrounds, sectarian origins, and so on. And so I think, in a way, I hope one of the subtexts of this lecture tonight is to challenge lazy generalizations about British Muslims and to factor in complexity. So just a little bit of sociology then, and then also to talk a little bit about, before we look at Islam per se, to look a little bit at the challenge of being a migrant community. Often we rush to a religious analysis of issues when they have more to do with the sort of dilemmas and predicaments of migration than religion as such. And then we'll talk about the specifics of Islam, the larger environment, post 9/11, post 7/7. And then we'll talk about religious leadership. We'll touch on a range of issues, not least religious leadership, and the crisis of authority in the Muslim communities today. Because there is a crisis of religious authority and a crisis of religious leadership in the Muslim community and how that plays out. And we'll look at how that plays out, particularly in intergenerational relations. I think, you know, there are now at least three generations of Muslims in this country, and they relate in a very different fashion to what counts for their grandparents as the homeland, Britain, and the wider Muslim world. And they negotiate those three relationships in a very different way. And so we'll look at some of the intergenerational tensions, really. And then also, what is often forgotten, specific challenges Sunni Islam, and we're mainly talking about the Sunni majoritarian Islam, the difficulties Sunni Muslims have in living well as a minority, and the challenges to the tradition, religious traditions of Islam, to live well as a minority. That creates also additional challenges, especially for the Muslim communities, 70%, two-thirds at least, to 70%, who have roots in South Asia. And the biggest Muslim community, of course, is that which has migrated from Muslim-majority countries like Pakistan and Bangladesh. And as we'll see, they're having to adjust and adapt to massive challenges, having been a majority in one context to a minority in another. And we'll look at some of those challenges of how you live well as a minority. And then some of the positives, the emerging patterns of engagement with British society. And one of the subtexts really there is, as we used to say and still do in peace studies, the agents of change in the Muslim communities are women. So I'll say quite a lot about Muslim women. So I think they're the most encouraging group. And when we look at Islam in its complexity, there's always been, so to say, a progressive movement in Islam for well over 100 years. But that has never been a social movement. And it may well be we're seeing in Britain and the West the emergence of progressive Islam carried by educated Muslim women, which could go from an intellectual trend to a social movement. I think that's one of the most interesting developments in the next 5 or 10 years. And then I'll conclude with a few comments about relationships, what the churches have done. And so this is very much broad brush. And I wanted, in a way, I'm assuming no knowledge. Some of you will have a good knowledge. Others of you really will have come here tonight knowing very little. And so don't worry. I'm not assuming any great knowledge tonight. those of you who have got a good knowledge and background, then in a way, minimally, at least you'll get some useful bibliographical suggestions of things worth reading. So hopefully there's something for everyone. And that's why I was saying to Mike, it's questions and answers are very important, because people have strong feelings about these issues. And so there needs to be space for you to be able to articulate your concerns and your questions. Okay, so we're going to start then, as you'll see with those who've got the notes, with a little bit of history, what I call history and memory, Islamic Sunni views of the West and Christianity. Now, what I've got there, I've taken those four categories, the age of triumph, the age of curiosity, the age of indifference, the age of bafflement. I've taken those four categories from a brilliant short article from a Muslim scholar, one of the finest historians of Islam today, Professor Tarif Khalidi. Now, some of you may know that George Carey was responsible for beginning a sort of annual conversation between Muslim scholars and Christian scholars in 2001 called Bridge Building, which is very appropriate for tonight's lecture. And I was fortunate to attend that meeting. It's unapologetically scholarly, and you get academics and others together, Christians and Muslims, to reflect at a serious level. And for me, easily the best paper in that consultation, and it's been published and since, was this by Tarif Khalidi. So Tarif Khalidi, then front rank historian of Islam, when he gave a paper, he was still lecturing in Cambridge. And he's now gone back, I think he's gone back to Lebanon to lecture in the American University. And basically, what in fact Khalidi said was that you have to use, he used those four categories to try and make sense of how Sunni majority Muslims view Christians stroke the West. And often they don't, in Muslim majority areas, do not distinguish between the West and Christianity. And he talked about the first age, the age of triumph, when Islam explodes onto the scene, when after Muhammad dies, within 50 years, Islam, the Arab world from being a backwater, explodes in conquest. And within 50-100 years, has conquered an empire from Spain to India. And he talks about the age of triumph then, this 7th to the 9th centuries. And he talks about the most prominent Quranic slogan is a verse which is repeated three times in the Quran. It was God, he, who sent his prophet, Muhammad, with right guidance and the religion of truth to make a triumph over all other religions. That'll do. I'll read that again. It was he who sent his prophet with right guidance and the religion of truth to make a triumph over all other religions. And he says that this was a verse found on earliest Islamic coins, inscriptions, a triumphalist statement, an affirmation that in the evolution of religions, Islam had finally triumphed over its tribal cousins, Jews and Christians. So this is a piece of religious triumphalism. Those Quranic verses, according to Khalidi, are then, so to say, validated on the battlefield by the totally unexpected conquest of the two superpowers of their day, Persia, who are obliterated by the Arab armies, and great swathes of the Christian Byzantine Empire. And that success, that military success, so to say, validated the truth of Islam over and against the other, religious other. So that's then the age of triumph or triumphalism. And then Khalidi's second period is the age of curiosity from the 10th to the 14th centuries. And this is a period, remember, when Islam is expanding into spaces which were, say, Persian Empire or Byzantine Christian Empire. Great swathes of the Christian Byzantine Empire remained for many centuries majority Christian, although with an Arab, so to say, elite superimposed upon it. And in this period, there was genuine curiosity. With the Arabization of the Byzantine Empire, for instance, the lingua franca became Arabic, scriptures were translated into Arabic. So Arabic became a conversational language which Christians and Muslims, and indeed Jews, could reflect on each other's scriptures And there was quite profound study of each other's scriptures in that period, hence the age of curiosity. However, the subtext is, it wasn't done in, as you might do in an MA seminar or a religious studies A level. You know, this was good and positive compared to this, which is not good and positive. The aim was polemical, to prove the other lot wrong. But nonetheless, there was serious, profound exploration of each other's texts. Then the third period, he talks about the age of indifference from the 14th to the 17th centuries. And he gives a wonderful comment. This is the age of the great Muslim empires. In India, the Mughals, Persia, Safavids, and of course in Europe and North Africa, the Ottomans. And he quotes Ibn Khaldun, a famous Muslim scholar, who hears about the Renaissance in Europe and comments thus, "It has reached us that the arts and sciences are once again finding a ready market in the academies of Europe. God knows best about this." It's as if Ibn Khaldun is saying, even God can work a miracle in this backwater, which is the West. Now, that is the voice of supremely confident imperial Islam. Now, remember, at this period, power lay in the Islamic world. There's a very good study called The Captives by the British historian Linda Colley, where she looks at four phases of how an emerging British empire runs up against powerful opposition. And she talks about the first phase up to about 1530s, and she talks about huge numbers of Brits from the southwest are enslaved by North African pirates and protected by the Ottomans. And attempts were made to buy back some of those captives, some of whom had become Muslim. Now, I had no idea if something like 25, 30,000 Brits had been captured in this period. You know, I had no idea at all. And she writes about this. Now, the point I'm making by giving that illustration is that in the 16th century, power didn't lie in London, it lay in Istanbul. This was the heart of a multi-ethnic, proud, powerful empire. Now, the point then is, so the age of indifference, no real interest in the West, it was a bit of a backwater compared to these sophisticated imperial cultures. But then he talks about Khalidi. The fourth cycle is the age of bafflement from the 18th to the 20th century. This is the age of Western colonialism. By the turn of the 20th century, three quarters of the Muslim world have been colonized by four or five Western powers. Now, colonization is always a shock, unless it's your own, of course. And as I mentioned earlier, Islam had its own early imperial expansionism. But the shock of when, as a Sunni Muslim, you're schooled into this narrative of preeminence and dominance, and that narrative is plausible for 1,000 years, and then for the last 2 centuries plus, history has gone all wrong for the Muslim world. Hence, the Age of Bafflement, the title of Khalidi's fourth phase. And here there was a readiness, unlike Ibn Khaldun, to acknowledge maybe the West has something to teach us. But what was that something to teach us? Science, technology, which was seen to be the reason for military success and dominance of the West, not Renaissance, Reformation, industrial society, and so on and so forth. And I talked to Khalidi at a conference some years ago, and I asked him, you know, in terms of the Arab world, does the Arab world have centers for really studying at a serious level the West? He said, apart from, say, the American university, a couple of American universities across the Middle East, no. So in a way, still the West is seen in terms of science and technology, not in terms of, if you will, the presuppositions which allowed that kind of scientific endeavor to emerge. And I in a way, you might add a fifth category to Tarif Khalidi's categorization, which is the age of humiliation. A proud Muslim world, looking around the world today, feeling a sense of bafflement and humiliation. What has gone wrong? And I think Sunni Islam, unlike Shia Islam, doesn't have what we might call a theology of suffering and defeat. And if you read as part of your Lenten discipline, Osama bin Laden's table talk, which has been translated, it breathes the air of a sense of humiliation. Now, we know in Western Europe, after the First World War, if nations or peoples feel humiliated, that can generate some fairly unlovely phenomena. So I think probably what I've said already in those 5 or 10 minutes, probably the most important thing I'm going to say to you all night, is to understand Islam, one has to have a long view, a sense of history. And this deep sense of, if you like, intellectual and spiritual malaise, still across the Muslim world, what has gone wrong? How has the God of the Quran, if you will, and the God of history parted company? Why are we in the Muslim world in such a mess, put simply? I flagged up a book in that same section by Michael Cook, a front rank scholar of Islam, who's just written a very interesting book called Ancient Religions, Modern Politics, The Islamic Case in Comparative Perspective. And I would recommend that book. He tries to make sense of what one might call contemporary Islam and its predicaments. And if you're interested in that, Cook's book is, I think, brilliant. Very good. And part of it is saying religious traditions are different, and those differences are not trivial. And I think one of the challenges of serious interreligious relations is not to pretend if you scratch us all, we're all the same, but how does one live well with radical difference? I think that's the real challenge of interreligious, intercommunity relations. Now, the next bit, we'll now move into a little bit of history in Britain. I'm not going to spend much time on this, the development cycle. I mean, the Muslim communities, although they've been here in small numbers for a few hundred years, the large Muslim communities only emerge in Britain post-Second World War with the labour shortage. You probably know all that, in the 50s and 60s. And so each country in Europe, if it's Germany, you're dealing with Turks. In each country, so to say, Islam is often seen through a specific ethnic lens. So in Germany, it's Turkish. In France, it's North African. In Britain, it's been South Asian. Although the Muslim communities are more complex than that. 70% of Muslims have roots in South Asia, Pakistan, Bangladesh, India. And that matters, as we'll see a bit later. And then you have what's called the myth of return and chain migration. What happened in a city I know best, Bradford, where I've lived for 30 years, certain villages, so to speak, had a link through the merchant navy with Britain, labor shortage. Those were the areas, rural Pakistan, the least developed areas often, who provided the labor in textiles, in foundries, in the northern cities, parts of Birmingham, parts of London, Walthamstow, and so on. So chain migration from usually not educated urban backgrounds, but rural backgrounds, and that, as we'll see, will also matter. And there's been a really helpful document which you can download by the Muslim Council of Britain, which I really do think is excellent, called Muslims in Numbers. It came out last year, written by a very sharp young Muslim sociologist from Oxford. And it actually shows you some of the complexity on the ground. Now, what she shows very clearly in those statistics, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the statistics. If you're interested, you can download it. But obviously what is happening is a successful middle class, professional middle class, has emerged now within the Muslim communities. And so, you know, she gives a few statistics. Between 2001 and 2011, the community grew from just over 1.5 million to 2.7 million. A very young community, much younger than the average. So, if you will, 2.7 million comprises 4.8%, less than 5% of the overall population. But if you look at children of school age, you're dealing with 8%. So this is a young, growing community. But what is really interesting is it's generating a successful, professional middle class. And so she notices that the proportion of Muslims in the higher professional and occupation category is now not so different from the overall population. Similarly, the percentage of Muslims over 16 with degree level and above is also very similar. And of the 330,000 full-time students, 43% are women. And we'll come back to women. This is going to, I think, have a massive impact on the Muslim communities over time in Britain. So that's the good news. You've got a very one significantly successful middle-class professional group emerging. And we'll come back to the implications of that a bit later. But then the downside is side by side with that, you've got an increasing community locked into the inner city, the least prosperous areas of many of our cities. And the statistic she gives is that in that previous 10-year census period, from 2001 to 2011, those living, the percentage of Muslims living in the inner cities grew from a third to almost a half. So you can see what's happening here. There's quite two distinct trajectories within the Muslim community. The inner city Muslims, who are, like many in inner city, are falling further and further behind for a whole set of reasons. And then a successful overlay, a middle class professional community, who are moving up and out. So two quite discrete trajectories. But then some of the social problems, again, I was very surprised to read this. If you've got just over 250,000 Muslim married households with dependent children, there are now 77,000 lone parent families with dependent children and 135,000 one-person households. Now, those are mind-blowing statistics. That suggests a community in crisis, divorce, single parents. We often think of Muslim communities as embedded in strong extended family units and networks. That is breaking down rapidly and quickly. I was really surprised by those statistics, actually. And then part of our problem, if you look at the prison population, it's 13%, when the overall community is 5%, much higher than it should be. So there's a section of the community, things are going badly wrong with a section of the community. So I just flag up what I think was an excellent report, which does reflect the fact that you've got quite distinct trajectories, socioeconomic trajectories now in the Muslim communities in this country. A successful professional middle class, but an increasing number falling further and further behind in the inner city. And that component has gone from almost a third to a half in 10 years of a Muslim community. So you can see already easy generalizations about Muslims. All the time we have to ask, who are we talking about? And where are we talking about it? And this really leads me into the next point. No one is a Muslim in general. In London, for instance, there are 100,000 Turks, mainly Turkish Cypriots. I suspect you didn't know that, and I suspect you didn't know it because they're invisible. They're Turks. And that matters because if you're a Turk, the Turks were never colonized. They were the colonizers of North Africa, other Muslims, the Arabs, as well as deep into Southern Europe. For half a millennium, they were one of the most successful empires. So they were never colonized. They're successful people with their own imperial past. Compare that with the Pakistani communities, the biggest Muslim community in this country, who are often referred to as the New Irish. They were colonized. You ask the Irish what they think about the Brits. You know? They were colonized. Colonization generates deep stereotypes of each other. So the Turkish experience is quite different in Britain. It's quite different from the Pakistani experience. If you've been colonized, you carry with you a very different set of memories into Britain than, say, the Turks did, for instance. Now, not only do you have those sort of broad contrasts, you also have different cities have very different profiles. So, for instance, Brent or Newham is one of the most multi-ethnic cities in the country, areas. You go to Leicester, that's, again, not as diverse as London, but most of its Muslims came from East Africa. They were kicked out under Idi Amin and others. They were grateful to find refuge in Britain. They were already English speakers after 50 years of being in East Africa. They had professional and commercial skills. They've done well in cities like Leicester, have enriched the economy. And they also carried with them good interfaith relations with Hindus, Sikhs, and others. So that's a different history to London, but an interesting and positive one. But come to a northern city like Bradford or Blackburn or semi urban mill towns or parts of Birmingham, and you've got a very different profile. As I said earlier, most of these migrant communities came from rural backgrounds. And I mentioned earlier, it matters, who are we talking about? Are they urban? Are they rural? Are they Turkish? Are they Pakistani? What memories do they carry with them into Britain? And that really does matter. And so when you think about Pakistani communities in Bradford, the city I know intimately, who came from one of the least developed areas of Pakistan, Mirpur. And I'm bound to say, I was giving a talk in London to a Pakistani community and they asked me where I was from. I said Bradford, and they all tut-tutted. They were all urban Punjabis. You know, these poor benighted souls, Kashmiris, you know, difficult to deal with, you know? So there's a pecking order within the Pakistani community, and the Kashmiris tend to be at the bottom of a pile, actually. So there's those attitudes within the Pakistani community itself. Now, when you think about it, these communities have made three massive changes in terms of migration. They've gone from majoritarian Muslim environments to a non-Muslim environment. They've gone from a rural to an urban area. The same communities would struggle in Karachi or Lahore from rural Kashmir. And they've gone from Eastern to Western culture. They're massive dislocations. How do you survive those psychologically? You recreate in the Bradfords, the Blackburns, parts of Birmingham, parts of London, the village you left behind, with all of the insecurities, the impatience and suspicion of officialdom, and so on and so forth. So again, you see, you know, when we talk in an easy fashion about the Muslim community, that's a very lazy, unhelpful generalization. Who are we talking about? Where are we talking about? What are the histories they've carried with them into Britain? All of that stuff matters. And I just want to ponder just a couple of minutes on this tensions brought by migration, and particularly the intergenerational tensions. And there's a lovely book on migration. And one of the best books I've ever read on the predicaments of migration is written by Eva Hoffman, which has a book called Lost in Translation. She was from a secular Polish Jewish family. They move off to Canada. And her experience resonated with what I saw on the ground living for 30 years in Bradford about migrant communities. And she talks about the elders, the parents' generation, the grandparents' generation, being caught between nostalgia and alienation. Nostalgia for the old country, which of course never remains the same and is seen in some kind of aspic, as it were. So when we get Pakistani educationists coming into Bradford, they're horrified. The community seemed to be sort of locked in a time warp. And then the next point she makes is that if you're a minority, the only way out of marginalization is linguistic competence, which enables you to translate anger into argument. I mean, it's a very telling phrase that. If you're frustrated and you can't articulate those frustrations, they tumble out, often into violence. So you have to, even when you master the language, then you can translate anger and frustration into argument. And then a third point she makes is that increasingly you have deep intergenerational conflicts. I mentioned already that the grandparents, for them, home is rural Pakistan. Often they wanted to be buried there. That's their reference point. For their children, it's less so, it's more Britain. For their grandchildren, they're British kids, English-speaking, educated here. So they have a differential set of relationships, both to the parents' or grandparents' homeland, Britain, and the wider Muslim community. And that expresses itself, as I've suggested, in two ways. One, there's the yummies. Of course, you're all aware of the yummies, young, upwardly mobile Muslims. They're the ones, you know, who are doing well in British society. They can afford expensive lifestyle magazines and so on and so forth. They're doing well. They provide a constituency for one of the most interesting and critical magazines out in the last 3 years called Critical Muslim. If you're interested, you know, look at Critical Muslim. It's a Muslim journal. I couldn't believe when I read some of that stuff. You know, but here are, you know, British Muslims really in self-critical mode. You know, and very refreshing to read this stuff. So there is, so to say, a constituency for this kind of literature now. But then, of course, side by side with the yummies, you have what a Muslim social psychologist has called the urban rude boys. Now, as we said, third to a half of Muslims living in the cities, that's the world of the urban rude boys. And the rude boys, this social psychologist, Muslim social psychologist, talks about, are a product of three worlds. Northern or Midlands working class industrial culture, which isn't a very lovely phenomenon, especially if you're a woman. Then secondly, rural Kashmiri culture, which is pretty damn chauvinist. And then put into the pot American gangster rap and hip hop, with which, of course, you're all intimately familiar. Where does Islam feature in that? The mosques, often places people are disillusioned with. And we'll come back to that in a moment. So what we've got here is really deep generational challenges for the Muslim community. Now, I'm not going to spend too much time, but the larger environment for Muslims is not an easy one, post 9/11, post 7/7, and I say a little bit about positives and negatives. It's not easy, as the Irish discovered after the bombing some 30 years ago, you know, when you become seen in British society as a suspect community. So just as the Irish were 30 years ago, so often Muslims are seen today. You're seen through a sort of that lens of a suspect community. And of course, there is a problem with violent extremists. It's a minority problem, but it's real. But I think we can leave that to the intelligence services and the counter-terrorist people. But we mustn't, in a way, simply allow that to be the dominant lens through which we look at Islam and its complexity. And that I think, is the problem. If you don't have the opportunities and the privilege of interacting with ordinary people, Muslim people, and your only interaction is through virtual reality of the media, the pictures of Islam are always seen through this selective image of the suspect community. So that's not to pretend there isn't an issue with violent extremism. Of course there is. But you can see how wearisome it must be for ordinary Muslims who all the time are on the defensive or feel themselves on the defensive. They've got to explain this or that atrocity which co-religionists are doing. And we remember that most of the victims of violent extremism are other Muslims, who happen to be the wrong Muslims. So I think we need to remember that. I'm not going to say much more about that. You can look at some of the details I've given on the notes. But I want to reflect on one of the really difficult issues, the fact that religious leaders, there's a crisis of religious leadership within the Muslim community. And I've organized my comments around three categories. There are many Muslims, the majority Muslim group in this country, are once sects who are called Deobandis. And they have over 20 seminaries in Britain, pumping out young imams. And their trademark, I would say, is isolationism. That, in a way, they generate a sort of almost a Manichaean worldview of us and them. Keep your distance. You know, be polite, but keep your distance from the non-Muslim. That, I think, is a characteristic, sort of isolationist mindset, really. If you want to understand these different categories of Muslims, mainly, you know, with certainly roots in South Asia, there's a very helpful book, accessible book, by BBC journalist Innes Bone, who spent 8 years working on this book, called, I've given you the title there, Medina in Birmingham, Najaf in Brent, Inside British Islam. In 8 superb chapters, she gives you an overview of a sort of sectarian diversity, because Islam came from somewhere else into Britain. Muslims from Pakistan or Egypt carried with them the Islam they were familiar with from somewhere else. And she maps those international relationships, so to say, and how there's the beginnings of change in some of those, groupings. So if you're interested in the diversity of Muslims in this country, especially if you're an RE teacher, I know there's one or two RE teachers here, Innes Bowen's book, I think, is a really helpful book for sort of A-level sort of students, really. So in a way, one strand of the imam, the world of the imams, is what I call isolationist. Another emerging strand, I've talked about engagement. So for instance, some of you will listen to Radio 4, Abdul Hakim Murad is one of the Muslims who talks on that. He's a convert, Tim Winter, who runs the Cambridge Muslim College. I think they're doing some quite interesting and constructive work on engagement and preparing some imams with the skills they need to make sense of British society. Islamic Foundation in Leicester has some useful courses. And then there's a bunch of imamsonline.com. Again, a bunch of Muslims who are trying to engage with wider society in a more constructive way, as well as delegitimize the sort of extremist ISIS-type narratives. So there are the emergence of those Muslims who want to engage. And then, of course, there's those who are in what I call resistance mode, the assorted mavericks like Anjem Chowdhury and other radical Muslims. And they're written about in a very helpful and intelligent way by a Muslim female activist, Sara Khan, who's just co-authored a very good book, if you're interested in this world, of sort of radical Islam, called The Battle for British Islam, Reclaiming Islam from the Extremists. A very brave woman, actually, who's put her head above the parapets. And you know, when you read this sort of intra-Muslim sectarianism among the more radical groups, you feel you're being thrown back into a 1980s sort of Labour Party militant tendency, this kind of intra sort of sectarianism which tore Labour Party, the Labour Party apart in the 80s. I make no comments about Mr. Corbyn. And what is evident, and we'll come back to this in a moment, is most of the religious leaders are not fit for purpose, do not have the skills and competences to connect in a relevant way to a new generation of British Muslims. That's the unpalatable reality. Some, a minority, are. So for instance, there was a study some 10 years ago saying that less than 10% of the imams in this country, in the mosques of this country, no, it was a 2008 study, were born and educated in Britain. That means the majority are not, 90%. I think things have changed a little bit in the last 10 years, but not hugely. Now, if you want to understand the challenges, and in the question time, we may want to revisit this. There's a brilliant, brilliant study by a young Turkish friend of mine, Abdullah Shaheen, he's now lecturing on Islamic education at Warwick University. And the book is called New Directions in Islamic Education. And I think it's one of the most important books come out in the last 20 years. And he did his PhD in Birmingham, and he studied a bunch of young Muslim sixth formers, mainly from South Asian backgrounds. And he discovered that these were British educated kids, as you'd expect. The majority had what he called an exploratory identity. They wanted to explore the relevance of what they'd been given by the mosque and the home for living well as a Muslim in 21st century Birmingham. So the majority had that exploratory ambition, aspiration. A small group had what he called a foreclosed identity, a prematurely formed religious identity, which was brittle, couldn't cope with questions and challenges. And another small group had what he called a diffuse identity, which, as it suggests, one thing one day, one thing the next. So they could be womanizing and drinking one day in the clubs one day, born again, Muslim the next. Diffuse, all over the place. No solid roots in their tradition. So three, that typology, exploratory, diffuse, foreclosed. He said the challenge facing the imams and the educators in the mosque is if they couldn't connect with that exploratory ambition to render Islam relevant to the complex world these kids lived in, they majority would become over time foreclosed or diffuse, which was a challenge to the Muslim communities and to wider society. Now, if you read biographies of radical Muslims, violent extremists, they invariably fall into the diffuse category or the foreclosed category. And so, you know, there was an article by Mehdi Hassan, a Muslim commentator in the press, about, you know, many of the young men going off to Syria. In their rucksacks, they had a copy of Islam for Dummies. You know, a lack of serious religious literacy, therefore vulnerable to any charismatic leader who comes along and says, this is what Islam is. Now, Abdullah was so concerned that the imams were failing to connect in a relevant way, the exploratory identity, he developed an innovative MEd program. And what he discovered, and which is now he's doing initially in Leicester and now in Warwick, he discovered actually that most imams were trained in such a way that they studied revered texts, but they didn't contextualize them. And so you might have a 12th century legal text, Hidayah, for instance, famous Sunni legal text, which is the product of the 12th century, the product of expanding empire. Who were the enemy? The other Christian imperial powers in 12th century Europe. So the Christian was the imperial enemy, so to say. But if you don't contextualize that 12th century legal text, the product of expanding and rival empires, what do you do with that in 21st century Birmingham or London or Bradford? So what he's tried to do is take the brightest of the imams in Britain, or selection of them, each year, and try and give them a year, you know, give them the historical and contextual skills to make sense of their own tradition, to find wiggle room, so to say, to rethink the tradition in relevant ways. So if you really want to understand the sort of tradition and the challenges it faces, Abdullah Shaheen's book, I think, is magnificent. And he maps out what he's trying to do and the sort of success he's beginning to have with at least a section, albeit at the moment it's a small drop in the ocean, but it's starting. It's a green shoot, if you have to change the metaphor. And a point, of course, one other point to make is a truism now, is that most mosques are not places you go to ask questions. You're there to imbibe the wisdom of the ages. You're not there to be part of a critical dialogue about Islam, to raise critical and difficult questions. And it means that a whole range of issues interesting to young British Muslims, sexuality, politics, are often ruled out of court. So where do you talk about these issues? Where do you look for a relevant leadership? A friend of mine talked about Sheikh Google or Wiki Islam. That's a lottery. So this crisis in religious authority matters. And so there are some positive developments, at least. One other book, as a counter, you know, in a way, a book which begins to map the more positive narratives, is a book by Shalina Jan Muhammad, came out this year, called Generation M, Young Muslims Changing the World. Irrepressibly, relentlessly upbeat as a kind of corrective to the normal, what she calls, misery memoirs about Muslims. But there's some good stuff about this, you know, what I call, you know, the Muslim professional class across the world, the English-speaking elites. They're often spoken of now, another term, the gummies, global urban Muslims, who are part of global cities like London, which are genuinely diverse places, or in parts of Malaysia or whatever, where you've got English-speaking elites, you know, who are critical, self-critical, and they want a much more engaged space to talk about Islam than this sort of, you know, sort of one-way street where they're told what to do, do's and don'ts. And so they're looking and generating some quite hopeful signs. Let me now just spend a few minutes on, again, something we often forget about, the challenges facing the Sunni majority to live well as a minority. What resources does the religious tradition of Islam have to live well as a minority, given that, I don't know, maybe one in four Muslims now live as minorities, and often very significant Muslim minorities. And the point here to notice, as we suggested when we began, is Sunni Islam is born to success and dominance, that wholly unexpected imperial success. And so it takes success and dominance for granted. And so Muslim theology, and it's one of the leading British Muslims, Dr. Zaki Badawi, who died some years ago, made the point 30-odd years ago, Muslim theology offers, up to now, no systematic formulation of being in a minority. All its religious disciplines from the first few centuries are, so to say, developed in a context of expanding empire and take success and dominance for granted. And so the challenge for Muslim scholarship is, how do you detoxify your religious disciplines of an imperial mindset, which takes as a given success and dominance? And so there's a beginnings of some Muslims trying to develop a theology of minority or legal practice for minority status. There's a beginnings of that now. Then the second example is, some years ago, an Indian Muslim, Sheikh Arbideen, realized that, quote, Muslims knew how to command or to obey. They had, through most of their history, really learned to live with others in equality and fraternity. He was so worried about this that he developed a journal 20-odd years ago of Muslim minority affairs, realizing that serious thought had to be given. How do we quarry our tradition, our religious disciplines, for resources to live well as a minority? Sounds very obvious. The Jewish community have had to do that for 2,000 years. Their predicament in Israel is quite different. Having been relatively powerless for two millennia, how do you bend and adapt your religious tradition to all the temptations of power? The Islamic predicament as a minority is the exact opposite. How do you adapt and adopt a tradition which took power and dominance for granted in this new situation of minorities? We have to share power, in democracies at least. And then there's a whole series of headings there. I think probably it's worth talking about, I won't talk about supersessionism, this view that Islam has superseded Judaism and Christianity. We touched on that already with Tariq Khalidi's Age of Triumphalism. I think one of the difficult problems contemporary Islam has is, if you look at the past, how have Muslim countries' empires managed Islamic diversity? Well, power has banged heads together, basically. The Sultan of a Caliph tells you, you know, what's going to go on, as it were. So they impose some kind of modus vivendi with different Muslim groups and different schools of law. But that's okay when you're in power. What happens when you're not, as a minority? And so we have that difficult situation of almost huge, unmanageable diversity coming into Britain, coming into the West. And very hard to manage. And one of the difficulties is an increasingly virulent sectarianism. And that sectarianism can be imported from Pakistan. That sectarianism across the Muslim world has been exacerbated by the Saudi petrol dollars. The Saudis project a particular reading of Islam, Wahhabi or Salafi Islam, which often is very literalist and intolerant of other sorts of Islam, adds a new level of intolerance, intra-Muslim intolerance. And then, of course, there's the politics of the Middle East. And I've given examples if you want to check up on that. And sadly, there's been some pretty horrendous murders recently, Muslim on Muslim, which you know, is deeply worrying, that internal intra-Muslim sectarianism is in danger of spilling over. And that's what a lot of Muslims worry about in the British context. But I've given a few comments there, and there's one or two websites you can look at. I mentioned Critical Muslim. It had an issue a couple of years ago, all devoted to sectarianism, the elephant in the room, if you will. Then one other point worth making is a what one, the social psychologist I mentioned earlier in a book called Wandering Lonely in a Crowd talked about cultural illiteracy. I think that's probably worth mentioning. The point he makes is that basically most Muslim activists pursue careers in technical, scientific, medical, financial, or legal professions. There are relatively few Muslim graduates in the humanities and social sciences. One consequence is that our expertise on issues of culture and engagement remains underdeveloped. And he gives an example. In the aftermath of 9/11, we couldn't muster one expert in American foreign policy from across the whole British Muslim community. By default, the career choices of our best and brightest means we remain culturally delinquent and are unable to recognize the subtleties required for the art of persuasion. So a paucity of Muslims going into arts and humanities. And that matters if you want to argue your corner. And I think there are other issues I've touched on in the notes, if you're interested, and I've put references. The fact that in a way, issues in the larger Muslim community are washing into Britain. And so, for instance, in the Islamic world, hugely influential is creationism in Muslim circles, which has been borrowed from American conservative Christians, ironically. But it's hugely influential. And again, I've given sort of references on that. If you want an accessible and readable book on these multiple challenges, I would recommend you read Mona Siddiqui's engaging autobiography called My Way. Some of you are familiar with Mona Siddiqui on Radio 4. I see a few nodding heads there. She's a professor of Islamics and interreligious relations at Edinburgh University. And I think her autobiography is hugely readable, engaging, but actually also, in what I've been saying, rehearses that from an insider's perspective. So I would recommend Mona's book. Let me just conclude that this section, and then I'll just spend a couple of minutes before we have questions. If you want a somber insight into the crisis of religious formation in South Asia, where most Muslims come from, there's a splendid new book by Ibrahim Musa, a South African Muslim, called What is a Madrasa? And I'll read you a telling phrase from his book. Musa, 35 years ago, was trained in South Asia, South African Muslim, in traditional Diabundi seminaries. And he returns 35 years on to try and find out whether the contents of the seminaries and the ethos have changed. And this is what he concludes. All experiments to accomplish a modest level of innovation in traditional Muslim educational circles in South Asia for over a century have been largely stillborn. Experiments to integrate multiple knowledge traditions to enhance the study of religious discourse has been shockingly incompetent. No madrasa integrates modern science, social science, and the humanities in conversation with the core traditional curriculum. And he goes on, which is a pretty depressing picture for us, because most of the seminaries here have their mother houses back in South Asia. Now, let me just talk a little bit about some of the positive stuff, just very briefly, really. And I mentioned Muslim women. And my sense is Muslim women increasingly are making it now in British society. In my own city, those who have done best in the local authority, so the most influential figures, are women. And so in Bradford, we have what's called a Muslim Women's Council, who set the cat among the pigeons last year by arguing for the first, in Britain, Muslim female governance mosque and a Muslim centre of excellence for women scholars. There's 100 mosques in Bradford. Now, why is there the need for that? Because women are systematically excluded from these mosques. And so these are the shakers and movers. The same in Birmingham. Go to Birmingham. There's a Muslim Women's Network. And they have recently wrote to the then Prime Minister Cameron and Jeremy Corbyn to protest about Pakistani male politics and saying that where there's substantive Muslim Pakistani politicians and community concentrations, Muslim women are being systematically excluded or marginalized from becoming councillors. These are Muslim women. They're feisty characters. In Birmingham, the woman in charge is a young South African, did a first degree in law in Britain, went back and did religious studies under an Islamic scholar in South Africa, who sat at the feet of one of the first American Muslim feminists. So this stuff is beginning to percolate through Muslim activist groups, and it's Muslim women who are the better educated ones, who are not going to be locked in to a sort of patriarchal package doled out by some of the more conservative Muslim groups in this country. So in many ways, I see Muslim women as really a hopeful sign, given the weight now of education. It's slow and there are other voices in the community. But this, I think, is becoming a very significant voice, these Muslim women. So for instance, in my own city, a couple of years ago, it was two Muslim women who initiated the Bradford Literary Festival. So, you know, a Bradford Literary Festival, and they had Muslim conversation partners. Who did they have for the first session? First session, they had Critical Muslim, the author Ziauddin Sardar. They had the leading American Egyptian feminist talk to them. They talked about violent extremism and how Muslims could critique that and engage a sort of other narrative, as it were. These are feisty women. Now, all of these, I think, are signs of hope in terms of interlocutors. And I think part of our role as Christians is to be supportive of those Muslims, of putting their heads above the parapets, wanting to engage with wider society and with us. And it's no coincidence that Mona Siddiqui has been involved in Christian-Muslim relations and has written a book on Jesus. You have a number of books on Christianity which exhibit a real knowledge of Christianity by Muslim scholars. You can count on your hands. But Mona has written one such. So again, you know, there's some helpful and encouraging green shoots here. Again, I could talk about other things, but I don't want to eat into the time for questions. And at the end, I've outlined a series of initiatives by churches to engage in partnership with Muslims of different sorts, as well as, I think, one issue, as I've said already, to get away from lazy generalizations and to challenge anti-Muslim hatred. There is Islamophobia around, and we have to acknowledge that and prejudice. As I said earlier, if your only interaction with Muslims is through the media, you don't interact with ordinary Muslims, you get a fairly fearful picture of Islam, with none of the positive stuff, some of the qualifications I've sought to make. But I do think, at the same time, if Christian-Muslim relations are to have integrity and some purchase with our communities, we have to have a space for mutual honesty. And there are hard issues in the Muslim community. Historically, we know if you leave Islam and become a Christian, historically that carries the death penalty, apostasy laws. Now, you can't enjoy the benefits of religious freedom in the West, but see religious freedom as a one-way street. One has to have a safe space to talk about some of these harder issues. I think it's very important that, I think, if Christian-Muslim relations, you know, are to have real purchase in our own communities as Christians, we have to have space to ask hard questions. And similarly, Muslims properly have got to be able to ask hard questions of us. So I think there's a new honesty emerging, I hope. Now, I hope what I've done is give you a bit of a tour de horizon, to throw out a few insights which I hope will be helpful, to understand the complexity of the Muslim communities, the need for Muslims to begin to develop a theology and legal practice for living well as minorities, which they don't possess thus far, and some of the challenges of being a minority for Muslims in Western society, given where Muslims have come from. So I've probably said enough. I'm sure you've got lots of questions.